Save me, O God, the water is up to my neck. I am sinking in deep mud, and there is no solid ground. I am out in deep water, and the waves are about to drown me. But I will pray to you, Lord. Answer me, God, at a time you choose. Answer me because of your great love, because you keep your promise to save. Save me from sinking in the mud. Keep me safe from my enemies, safe from the deep water. Answer me, Lord, in the goodness of your constant love. In your great compassion, turn to me. Don't hide yourself from your servant. I am in great trouble. Answer me now. Come to me and save me. Rescue me from my enemies. In these human words, God's voice is heard.
All things made you. Here's what I feel. Nothing matters more than love.
Friendship and affection, real connection. It's a gift from above.
Every song that we play,
every prayer that we pray, makes a bond in a way that's profound.
We're just here to spread that love all around. wouldn't work. Well, before I enter ministry, you knew me as Goldie Hawn. I'm laughing. That just got you old that cage. Would you please breathe for me and pray with me? Let there be peace among us, and let us not be instruments of our own brother's oppression. And now may God's word be spoken. May only God's word be heard. Amen. Since marriage equality became a national reality in this country, the religious right has beefed up their attacks on the dignity of LGBTQ people. Laws have been passed in Mississippi, in Alabama, in Texas, and proposed in other Bible Belt strongholds to allow discrimination against LGBTQ people in the name of religious freedom. It's not an argument, really, to say religion gives me the freedom to deny you freedom. And if you don't accept the denial of your freedom, you're denying my freedom to be religious. It's a circular argument, and it's not about justice at all. They cite a few Bible verses as to why they believe their hatred or fear of queer people is justified and righteous, but that's an old game. That technique was used to keep women out of ministry, and still is in some denominations. That technique was used to justify slavery, child abuse, and even the divine right of kings. Just because we can find something in the Bible covers a period of over 1,100 years, 3 continents, multiple languages, you can find anything. In fact, the Bible is a library. You can find anything at the library. If you look hard enough, you will find something that you're looking for in the library. And so just because we find something in the library, that doesn't settle the discussion. Just because we find something in the Bible doesn't mean that we can't change how we understand it or apply it. It doesn't mean that we shouldn't look at the larger witness and see how the Bible even argues with itself and then decide which side we will be on in that discussion. In fact, compassion and justice will demand that we challenge oppressive readings of Scripture, especially when people are being hurt by those readings. Here's something that should seem obvious to you, but in case it doesn't, let me not even on this. Readers make meaning. We read a thing, and then we decide what we think it means. And so if what we think it says is mean and hateful and exclusive and ugly, and then maybe that's about what we've brought to the text, as much or more than what we've pulled out of it. Because I promise you, for every instance that you can see a reason to deny someone or exclude someone or shame someone or condemn someone or demonize someone, I can bring a different perspective to that and find it to say something very, very different. There's only a handful of Bible verses, about half a dozen, that people use to terrorize same gender-loving people and gender non-conforming people. And I can deconstruct all of those verses. In fact, if you look at your sun verse, I have. We can take that home with you. And I can point out many more places in Scripture where same gender love and gender nonconformity are featured and celebrated and blessed. But I'm tired of doing it. I'm tired of playing biblical tit for tat. I'm especially tired of playing biblical tit for tat with the biblically illiterate. If the Bible is your reason for being cruel, or if you need a Bible verse to motivate you to be kind, your brokenness is clinical and needs more help than any Bible verse could possibly provide. Religious rhetoric that is
has used to dehumanize and demonize LGBTQ people or anyone. Religious rhetoric that is used to demonize and dehumanize people is what emboldens the less stable among us to do terrible things. Preachers of prejudice and hucksters of hate are what led to the AIDS crisis being ignored by our government for most of the AIDS. False prophets and vivacious priests must share the blame for Matthew Shepard's murder, for Harvey Milk's assassination, for the slaying of the Pulse 49, and for the transgender people who live in constant terror, including the dozens every year who aren't allowed to live anymore. I was serving a church in Texas a long time ago in the early 90s. And I got a phone call from a young man I didn't know. He called to complain about his mom. Made sense to me. And Paul Strange complained about his mom, why not? And but you know, he picked me for a reason. He said, my mom has come out as a lesbian. And I told him that was to take a lot of courage for her. And she probably really wanted him to try to understand, be happy for her, being able to live out her truth. And he said, I don't care that she's a lesbian, but does she have to be a dyke? I asked, do you know what a lesbian is? And he assured me that he did. And he even liked his mother's new partner. But she just didn't come out and take a new partner. She stopped wearing makeup. She shaved her head. She started wearing tank tops and combat boots. And I said, well, those would be my fashion choices. But if they make her happy, what's the problem? And he said, well, she was never like that. I miss my mom. There it is. So I explained that his mom didn't go anywhere. In fact, his mom was probably becoming more authentically who she was than ever before. She was probably going to be able to be more present to him in ways that he could never even imagine. I explained that she might have been dressing before to meet other people's expectations. Or she might simply now be experimenting with her newfound freedom, trying to find ways to express herself authentically. Or that she might have just happened upon a look that she liked and thought she'd try it on for a while. I assured him that with or without hair, with or without tank tops or combat boots, she probably loved him dearly and would feel even closer to him if she knew that his love for her couldn't be diminished by how she wore her hair or by whether or not her companion was a woman. He said he felt better and would try to work for it. I later met his mom. She was a kind person. She wore big hoop earrings with her bald head and had all kinds of fresh new tattoos, which, by the way, is a big political no-no. No one seems to care about that, though. A lot of people in this room are in a lot of trouble. Including the person in the pulpit. But she was a lovely person. And her new partner turned out to be her life partner. They were together until she died from cancer only a couple years ago. They were together over 20 years, and only death managed to separate them. Her son is probably now in his 40s, and I bet he would love to have his mom back with any kind of hair or wardrobe. As we heard in the choir happen this morning, all things being even, here's what I know. Nothing matters more than love. In the 90s, also in the 90s, in my chaplain days, I was summoned to a nursing home where a young man was dying. His mother was a member of a fundamentalist church that had taught her son that because he was gay, he would be rejected by God and have to spend eternity in hell. For being gay. For being fabulous. For enjoying the Donna Summer mix. Dance it is.
for being attracted to pecs instead of cleavage. For finding 5 o'clock shadow charming. For wishing to be held in arms that might be hairy. Unless one passes, as I do. Really? For that, a god would damn someone for all eternity? A human with a heart wouldn't damn someone for all eternity for that. And if God isn't as good as nice people, no wonder fewer people have much time for God.
Yes,
of course, the fundamentalists have badly mishandled God's PR. And not just the fundamentalists. There's a Roman Catholic bishop in Illinois. You've read about him. That he doesn't even want priests in his diocese to do funerals for same-gender-loving people who are legally married. In fact, he has prohibited it. That's not the gospel. That's not the love of God. I still believe that God is love. No matter how many people get it wrong, no matter how many people worship their hatreds and their prejudices and call it God, no matter how many people take their prejudices and their hatreds and their fears and their dislikes and their distinct and wrap it up in the language of virtue, no matter how much that happens, I believe God is love. And I also believe that genuine love mutually shared is never a sin. In fact, I believe when two adults make a mutual decision to do almost anything that they enjoy, it's hard to make it sinful. But that was not the message this young man had heard growing up. And now, he was in the final stages of AIDS. His mother called him. She was guilty for passing on to him a faith that condemned him and robbed his joy and stole his hope and his dignity. And he was not only afraid of God, he was afraid he had disappointed his mom. He was afraid that somehow he had brought on this pain and misery that he was experiencing. He was immobile in a nursing home bed, too sick to live and too afraid to die. He was terrified of meeting this God who hated him simply because he was wired to be attracted to men instead of to women. It's as ridiculous as believing God would damn someone for preferring broccoli to carrots. But this young man's fear was very, very real. And his mother just wanted him to have a moment of peace before he died. She wanted to give him something better than the religion she had given him before. She wanted him to not spend his final moments in terror. And so I visited him in that nursing home. And I told him that his mother loved him very much, that she went to great lengths to find a minister like me and to tell the story and to have him come and spend time with him, that she wanted him to be comfortable and to know that he was loved. And I asked him, do you believe that your mother loves you? And he said, he did. And I asked, do you believe she wants you to be happy and that nothing could make her not love you and that you'll be part of her for the rest of her life? And he said, yes. And I said, well, guess what? In the Bible, the prophet Isaiah wrote this, like a mother comforts her child, so will God comfort you. I told him that I believed that God loved him at least as much as his mother did, and that God would love him forever. And I could see the tension start to dissipate. His body relaxed. And a few hours later, he died. I'm so glad for families that make the effort to work it out, to pray through it, to let love prevail over doctrine or dogma or tradition. I'm so happy for families that say, if I have been told that God doesn't love my children or my parents or my siblings for exactly who they are, I have been misinformed. And I'm so sorry for those who don't have those kinds of families. But I'm thankful that you can find new families that will love you for who you are and affirm your sacred value. I believe that God is an omnipresent love that will never and can never let any of us go. I wouldn't want to spend eternity with any other sort of God. I certainly wouldn't want to spend eternity with a God who would reject someone because they prefer broccoli to carrots. Or who like both equally, as some seem to do. I would rather be damned for love than spend a single moment in a heaven that required it. But I don't believe anyone is damned. And I certainly don't believe anyone will be damned for mutually shared love. Love, by definition, is unconditional acceptance. If God is love, God accepts you. We are told that God is omnipresent. That means everywhere fully present. If God is everywhere present, there's nowhere to be where God isn't. We can't be separate from God. God is love, which is unconditional acceptance, and God is omnipresent, which means we can't get away from her. And so this idea that we can be separated from or damned by God is ridiculous. And that love would be the line in the sand is even more ridiculous. And I don't care what Bible verse you find, or what verse you find in the Bible or the Quran or Mad Magazine, it's time that we say, I believe in my love first and foremost. Being torn apart over homophobia that is blessed by misguided religious people, and I'm tired of people being afraid that God's love isn't for them. In the reading from the Psalter this morning, we see the psalmist tired and afraid and singing for his life, singing prayers to give him comfort and courage and strength. And I too get tired and angry, and sometimes I'm scared, but I'm also hopeful, and I'm determined, and I'm motivated, and I know who I am, and I know who we are. And so today, I have a prayer. I have an affirmation. It's a familiar song. Today, I want us to sing our way into an awareness of God's presence. I want us to sing our way into an affirmation of who we are and who God makes to be. I want us to sing our way into comfort and strength and courage and motivation and dedication. I want us to sing for our lives. And so, it's a familiar song. It's a song of justice. If you know it, please sing it with me.
I see your
May God look upon us kindly and grant us peace. Amen.
Amen.